Hallelujah. What a pleasure to be here today. And you know, I came with just an expectation, a feeling of excitement, realizing that there was going to be so many people that are hungering and thirsting for something from God. And God never disappoints. He'll always satisfy you, praise God. Well, you may be seated. I've got some really good news. First of all, we're going to have a great service today. You know, as pastors normally do, we preach our message several times throughout the week. Forever who walks into our office, and I happened to be with Pastor Tim, and he was sharing me some of his thoughts. I thought, oh, that is going to be an outstanding message. But there's going to be something taking place this afternoon. It's going to be our unity service, or I should say, you know, early evening. Normally 6 o'clock we would gather together for Edify. But all of the churches in the section are coming here for a unity service, and you're going to want to be here. They have a special speaker, Brother Dobbs, is going to be with us, and it'll just be an outstanding service. It's something you will not want to miss. Got some other good news, and that is that we've had some new births, and we're always excited about new births. So baptized in Jesus' name is Matthew Ponga, and Abana Nare received the baptism of the Holy Spirit this past week. I'm just so excited when we see people coming into His kingdom. And so we want to pray for this service, and would you stand with me? And I'm going to ask us to also pray. You're aware of so many things that are taking place around the world. I know that these things that are happening really are positioning us, I think, to really receive something from God. But it also it puts a responsibility on us, and that is to pray. We have a number of families here that they have family members in Puerto Rico. They're not even able to have any contact with them. It's my understanding the conditions are so bad there that there are relief organizations that want to get in and cannot. And as a result, only the military can get in to try to help. Oh, that's a terrible situation. But I know my God is victorious. Amen. And I know He'll help in a time of trouble if we'll pray. So let's pray for them, and of course there are other people suffering from things that have happened in this country and out of the country, and let's hold them all up to the Lord, that they would seek God, and that they would be able to receive something from Him, and I believe that God will answer that prayer. Would you say amen? And then pray for the service. Praise God. Hallelujah. And while I'm making that point, I realize while you're standing, I'm holding in my hand a Connect card. We're grateful for every one of our guests that come. Thank you for being with us. And, we are trying to do everything within our means to be able to have your needs met. And when you come here, many times people are looking, they're searching for something, and you might very well be. And we realize that coming into a service is one way that we can help you, because I think the message you're going to hear is going to be beneficial. But on the other hand, we realize there are many other things this church offers that may be a help to you. And you won't know about them unless we connect with each other. So there's a Connect card in the pew pocket ahead of you. And if you would fill this out, we're asking you to do that. If you're a first-time guest, take it in back by our guest services area. And if you give it to them, they've got a gift for you. And they're there to answer any questions that you might have. In fact, if you want prayer, they'll pray with you. And so in addition to that, if you're a second-time guest, if you fill out a card again, it means something to us. We have kind of an understanding that if people come back again and they fill out a card, that we are going to be very proactive in reaching out to them. And so make sure that you fill that card out, and if you're a second-time guest, put it in the offering plate. Would you do that? Let's pray now. Amen. Gracious Father, we come to you, Lord, with hearts filled with thanksgiving for what you've done. And Lord, you give us, Lord Jesus, an invitation to come to you for what you might do. And so we pray in Jesus' name, Lord. Lord, that you would remember, Lord Jesus, Lord, those that are suffering in Puerto Rico right now with all the flooding that they've got, homes destroyed, families displaced, dear Lord Jesus. And Lord, it seems as though there's no means of helping them, but we know, Lord, you're a helper in a time of trouble. Lord, we ask, Lord, that you would do, Lord Jesus, the miraculous for them, dear Lord Jesus, in providing help, not just there, but other families, Lord Jesus, that have been touched by these natural calamities and disasters, Lord. And I know, Lord, at times like that, that we tend to look up. And Lord, you're always there for us. And we pray, Lord, your blessing upon them. We ask, Lord, that you'll have your way in this service, Lord Jesus. Minister to the needs of everyone that's here. We'll give you all of the thanks and the praise for it. It's in Jesus' name we ask it. You may be seated. We're going to watch our announcement video.
Everything. morning and welcome to the weekly Parkway Church video update. My name is Ty and I will be giving you a brief look at all of the events happening right here at Parkway Church. Tonight at 6 p.m., Parkway Church is hosting the Wisconsin District Section 2 Unity Service. Reverend Michael Dobbs will be the special speaker at that event. All families, youth, and children will be in the Worship Center. Coming up this Friday at 6:45 p.m., Christian Life Church in Mequon, Wisconsin will be hosting a Section 2 Kids Rally. For more information on transportation, you can email 4U@theoakcreekchurch.com or refer to your 411 information sheet. Next Sunday, October 1st, Milwaukee Life Chain will be taking place from 2 p.m. to 3:30 p.m. The Milwaukee Area Life Chain is a public, peaceful, prayerful protest for life. For more information, you can see Jamie and Pat O'Dowd. We are very excited to be hosting Reverend Irvin Baxter on October 8th and October 9th. On Sunday, October 8th, Brother Baxter will be speaking in our 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. services. On Monday, October 9th, he will be talking on the topic From Here to Armageddon at an End Time Prophecy Conference right here at Parkway. That will begin at 7 p.m. There are flyers for that event on the Parkway Happenings wall. Married couples, save the date. The 2018 Parkway Church Marriage Retreat will be happening on February 9th and 10th at the Abbey Resort. The cost will be $175 per couple, and that includes your meals, your registration, and your hotel, as well as activities. Registration for the marriage retreat opens up on October 2nd. For more information, you can email 4U@theoakcreekchurch.com. As always, if you have any questions about anything that we've announced, you can visit our website, www.theoakcreekchurch.com, stop by the Parkway Happenings wall, or pick up a 411 information sheet. Now please enjoy this service.
Let's all stand again this morning. I'm going to worship him this morning because he is worthy of our praise. Hallelujah. I will bless the Lord.
I will bless the Lord.
I will pray.
I will praise his name.
worship him this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord, we worship you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord Jesus. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone by your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come fly. Place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, there's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our
your kingdom move. All our faith and hope.
Our faith and hope, our grace.
Let's put our hands in the air and just thank the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 It's giving you an invitation to receive more than you can even imagine receiving from Him. See, our faith and our hope is in our great God. Our hope for this nation is in our great God. Our hope for the world is in our great God. We try fixing the problems. They just don't get fixed. We try fixing it with politics. And this isn't a political speech, but it doesn't work. If you want to know what works, you just go back to the beginning. You see, what God does is He does through His people. He does through His body. He does through His church. And in the very beginning, this is what was said about those followers of the resurrected Savior, the living Christ. They said, "These are those that have turned the world upside down." Hallelujah. Amen. We're a part of something that can change the world. You and I are a part of something that can change the world. Let's just thank the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh God, I thank you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. You can take your seats and praise the Lord. I want to just say something about that early church. I will tell you, I think we have a tendency to complicate things. How many know what I'm talking about? We take something simple and we try to make it, you know, better. But by doing that, I think sometimes we just add confusion to it. The reality is the early church did a few things and did them very well. A few things that they did very well. But we have a fall campaign coming up called a 30-day challenge, and that whole campaign, that whole series has to do with taking the few things the church did and doing them well. And I wish I could say the best way to receive that information and be able to utilize it is to just show up on a Sunday morning and listen to a message and that would be it. But the reality is that doesn't make a habit. it many times it might get us to think a little bit different, but it takes more than that. It takes applying principles on a daily basis. And so we're doing everything that we possibly can to help you to make that happen. And I will tell you the very best way to receive this information is to get a journal. We're going to be providing journals on the 15th for everybody here. For every guest that comes in the door, we're going to provide a journal. And that will help them every day for 30 days with their journey. And also, I encourage everyone to be in a small group. If you're not in a small group, you're missing one of the keys to making your life, you know, entirely different. And I will tell you that that we have over 50 small groups in our congregation, and many of them are full. And many of you will want to get into a group, so we're creating groups for you. So there will be groups for you to be in. And I sent a letter out to some of you. You know who you are, and some of you have responded. But I'm asking you if you'd be willing to take a small group. And if you said, you know, Pastor, I'm not sure that I know exactly how that works, or what it is that you'd like me to do in this small group, well, I'm going to provide that training on the morning of the 15th after that service, after we cast the vision for it, and it won't take very long, and I'll just lay that out for you. So I'm looking forward to hearing your response, and would you come? So what are those principles? Well, I can tell you one, because it has to do with this aspect of worship right now, and that is that we have an opportunity to express generosity. We do. We need to have generous hearts. Would you say amen? And this is an expression when we give to the cause of Christ and the work of Christ. And so for ushers to come at this time, we want to give an expression. An expression of not only what God has done for us, but an expression of hope in what God can do with our resources if we would give. Would you say amen? It's all true. Praise God. These are principles that we find in God's Word. That's just one of the very simple principles that can transform the world by the grace of God, by the power of God, and by the Spirit of God that we've been singing about. Where God touches earth, but He does it many times through us and through a message of hope. Praise God. Father, again, we're grateful. We are a privileged people. Thank you. Thank you for what you've done in our lives. We owe you such a debt of gratitude, Lord. And our giving isn't to pay a debt. You paid it all, Lord. But we want to participate, Lord. We want to be involved just as you gave in giving, to be able to make a difference, dear Lord Jesus, Lord, in the lives of so many people. We pray, Lord, that you will take these gifts, Lord Jesus, and use them to accomplish your purpose, for your glory, and we're going to give you all the thanks for it. Thank you for letting us be involved. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We see how great is the love, how great.
saved us, you forgave us. Thank you for the way you have freed us. We have been ransomed, we've been rescued, we've been purchased by the price of your own life. Thank you for the way that you love us. Jesus, faithful King, Lord, with grateful hearts we see how great is the love, how great is the love of our Savior.
Song we used to sing, and the words went something like this. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. How great is the love of our God for us? So great that he was willing to lay down his flesh, that he would give of his blood, that every sin, everything that I'd ever carried in my life could be all washed away by the blood of the sacrifice. I'm thankful today for the love of Jesus. You know, it's always at times difficult. I want to sing again. I really do. But there's a couple of things that I need to do today. And you can stay in a spirit of worship and don't quit on me right now. But there's a couple of things that I have to do. And they're very important. And they're important that you would be made aware of them. Pastor made reference to a number of things that indicate that there are signs everywhere of things that are happening, things that are amiss, things that are amuck in our world. And as many of you know, I was not here last week, and I was doing guy stuff. I was out in the woods. For all you carpenters, I framed in a window, put a window in. It opens, so it might not be perfectly square, but it opens and closes. But I was in the Black River Falls area, and the highlight of that town is the Culver's and the Walmart. And I had to go to Walmart because you can't go up north and remember everything, right? You forget stuff on purpose so you can go to the store. And so I'm pulling into the Walmart, and they have this big green space out in front of the store. And on this day, the entirety of the green space was covered by these little white crosses. And there was a sign, and it says, "Every cross represents the life of an unborn child that is snuffed out." You know, there are many signs around us that there are things that are amiss and amok. And we as the people of God often, unfortunately, become desensitized to the sin and the degradation that is around us. The statistics tell us that on average there are nearly 4,000 unborn children that are murdered every day in this country alone. And if you were to look around the world, that average would be closer to 125,000 unborn children that never get to live their life, that never get to experience the things that you and I do. And when I saw that, I was so grieved in my heart. I thought, God, how is it that you can still bless us? How is it that you can still see us as a nation that believes that we are a people that are under one God, when in so many ways we have forsaken your ways? I would tell you that there are things that we must be a part of. There are times that the righteous have to be heard. There are times that the righteous can no longer sit in apathy on the bench, but they must get involved. The voice of the righteous must be heard, not simply in an altar, but in our local governments, on our national governments. You see, because we truly, as Pastor said, can change the world with a message. The Bible says that the charge was that they turned their world upside down when in all reality we know that the world was flipped right side up. You see, because our priorities are wrong, we are selfish and full of ourselves. And so rather than being responsible, we look for ways of convenience. And then we say it's okay. I say all that to say this morning. I received two letters this past week. One asking that every one of our community leaders, every one of our small group leaders, every one of the members of this congregation would be in prayer and would raise up a voice against this atrocity in our nation. Next Sunday is the national event for Life Chain, and every year there is a very small handful of people from this church who go and stand on a street corner with some signs to represent the kingdom of God, to represent an alternative. And I'm thankful for those people. But I wonder if there's more of us that could do something. I wonder if there's more of us that would say next Sunday between 2:30 and 3:30 maybe. There will be a table in the foyer. There will be materials that are available. That you would see Sister O'Dowd and you would say, count me in, I'm coming. We're not looking to be like the protesters that you see on the news. We're not looking to bully anyone. But we want to exude with the love of Christ. That they would see the hope and the possibility of relationship with Him. So I wonder if you would be so moved that you would be a part of that. The other thing that I would tell you is having an understanding of these things. Pastor mentioned the hurricanes and the devastation, the earthquakes in Mexico. I mean, it's everywhere. A terrorist acid attack in London again. It's everywhere we look. The signs are becoming very apparent that the return of the Lord is near. By the way, I'm thankful to be in church with you today. I really thought I was going home yesterday. They told me the world was ending yesterday, but I'm glad they were wrong. I really wanted to be in church today. But we have Irvin Baxter coming October 8th. So that's 2 weeks from today. He will be with us in the morning and the evening service, and then he'll also be here for the Monday night. And we'll be speaking about end times. I had somebody stop me as I walked in this morning into the foyer, and they said, Pastor, give them heaven. And I thought, you know, that's good. Because there's enough hell that we're all living in that it would be good to hear a little bit about what God has for us. And so while I have you standing on your feet, there is one more thing that I want to do this morning. We are going to go to the Word of the Lord. And I have a number of things, obviously, that I've already mentioned that we need to pray for. But this morning, if it's possible, this is the one time, and not, most of you parents, all your children will be in Sunday school, so they won't learn a bad habit. But if any of you that are going to Kenya today, we have a number of people that are going to Kenya today, if you feel stable enough, climb up on your pew so that everybody can see you. Pastor, I just gave him permission. I'm sorry. Better hope your shoes are clean. And here's what I want you to do. We're going to pray for this message. We're going to pray for these needs. But I want you, as you see these people, just to extend a hand to them. They need traveling mercies. They need an anointing of God to be upon them, that they could affect change where they are going. We have some that are serving in Sunday school that are not in here this morning. But would you pray with me? If you're close and it's appropriate, lay a hand on them and pray for them. Heavenly Father, we love you this morning. We thank you for your faithfulness, for your goodness, for your grace. Lord, I pray today, oh God, Lord, that there would be something that is stirred within us, God,
that we would have an understanding, Lord, that we have the power and the ability to affect change in this world, God. Lord, that your spirit would rise up within us, God, and that we would be moved to a place of action today. Lord, I pray for each of these, God, that are going on this missions trip. Lord, that you would be with them. God, that you would give your angels charge over them, that you would protect them and keep them. God, that you would put a word in their mouth, God, that you would place an anointing upon them. Lord, that they would go and share and be effective for your kingdom. Lord, we ask this in the mighty and matchless name of Jesus. We thank you for it today. If you have your Bibles, I would ask that you would open them. I have three verses of scripture that I'm going to make you ending while I read them this morning. But Genesis chapter 3, so the very first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 3, verse 8, and then you're going to go all the way to the last book of the Bible. I'm sorry, projectionist, I'm out of order. I'm going to go all the way to the book of Revelations, and then we're going to finish in 2 Samuel chapter 9. So I'm going to work you just a little bit here. Genesis chapter 3, verse 8 says this. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. Revelation chapter 1, verse 6. And hath made us kings and priests unto God and his Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. And then if you would very quickly turn to the book of 2 Samuel chapter 9. 2 Samuel chapter 9. And we're going to read one verse of scripture here, verse 13. 2 Samuel 9, 13. And it says this, so Mephibosheth dwelt in Jerusalem, for he did eat continually at the king's table, and was lame on both his feet. Would you set your Bibles down, and would you just offer up a hand clap of praise to the Lord this morning? Lord, we thank you for your word, forever settled in heaven. We thank you, O God, for the freshness and the refreshing that comes through your word. Let your spirit be alive in this place. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Hallelujah. You may be seated this morning. So we find here in the book of 2 Samuel a story about a man by the name of Mephibosheth. And so I don't have to continue to stumble over that tongue-tying name. I'm just going to call him Mephib for the rest of the day, okay? So Mephib was the grandson of King Saul, the first king of Israel. He was the son of Jonathan, who was David, the second king of Israel, his best friend. And we find here in the early life of Mephib that the nation of Israel was in turmoil and at war. There was some things that were going on. There was a time period here where David was running. He had been anointed to be the next king of Israel. And Saul was doing everything that he could to find him and to extinguish his life. But in the midst of all of this, the nation of Israel is at war. It's in turmoil. And there is this fierce battle between the armies of Israel and the armies of the Philistines. And we find in this battle that many men were killed. Many of the Israelites lost their lives, and many fled the battlefield. It is here at Mount Gilboa that King Saul and all three of his sons are killed. Jonathan and his two brothers, dead in the battle. And when the news comes back to the king's palace that the king has died and the heir to the throne has died, the whole place goes in panic. You see, you have to understand the culture of the day. What would happen when a new king would arise to power and authority, he would search out every male child of the last king's family, and he would kill them. The reason for that was because they were afraid that somewhere down the road there would be an uprising and that the family would try to restore their lineage to the throne. And so the news comes back to the palace that the king had died and his sons had died. And Mephib's nursemaid, the babysitter, the caretaker for this child, hears the news. And in her haste to escape with the child, to protect him from what she thought was coming, begins to run from the palace. And the Bible says that in her haste, she stumbles and falls. And drops the child. In dropping the child, she injures him. The accident causes him to become lame or crippled. Historians tell us that he was paralyzed from the waist down, unable to walk right, paralyzed from this fall. He is taken to a place called Lodabar. And here he grows up in hiding, loneliness, and constant fear. The fear of being discovered, the fear of death. The name of the place Lodabar means a place of no pasture, no hope, a place of total desolation. Lodabar was known in Bible times as a ghetto town. It was a desert place, lacking enough water and refreshment, a place of loneliness and despair. This was the place that the babysitter had brought Mephib to hide out, thinking that no one would come looking for him there and that he would be safe. And she was right. This story is a parallel to all of us here today. We have all been crippled by a fall. The fall from right relationship with God, which came through the disobedience of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. When God said, touch not, and they partook of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And we know, as we read, that they hid themselves from God. We have sustained an injury so grievous that we cannot possibly walk right under our own power and ability. In the book of Galatians chapter 5, the Apostle Paul writes and tells us of the malady that we suffer from is a sinful nature. And the symptoms of this nature are things like adultery, sexual immorality, lustful pleasures, rage, jealousy, selfish ambition, dissension, division, drunkenness, and other similar sins. We find ourselves in a place that is desolate and lonely, but a place that has become familiar and is now home. These are Mephib's two greatest and distressing problems. Not a lack of reprieve, not a lack of refreshing, but rather his crippled feet and his fear of one day facing the wrath of the new king. He is a picture of the sinner who is hiding from God, unhappy in their life situation and with the choices that they've made, worried about the future and the destiny that seems to be one sure of death and judgment. We find then in the account that David, after having conquered all of his enemies and his kingdom now being at peace, he sits in his throne and he begins to reflect on the events of his life. And somewhere in the moment of his reflecting, he remembers a time with him and his friend Jonathan, as they stood out in the field talking about what would take place and the fact that David would eventually have to go and hide, that he would have to run from the king, Jonathan's father. And they make a covenant to one another. They make a promise that if I should live, I will treat your family, your offspring, with the kindness of God. And I will show them favor. They reciprocate this covenant to one another. And so as David is sitting here on his throne reflecting, he remembers this promise that he made to his friend Jonathan. A promise that he would treat his family with a faithful love. A promise made during a time where he most certainly could now justify casting aside that commitment. So David calls his servants and he asks a question. Chapter 9, verse 3, he says, the Bible says, "And the king said, is there not any of the house of Saul that I may show the kindness of God unto him? And Ziba said unto the king, Jonathan hath yet a son, which is lame on his feet." The day of reckoning that Mephib had feared all his life has come to his house. There is a knock on the door, and he has said that the king invites you to come to see him. Mephibosheth knows and is sure that this is the last day that he will live. This is the last day that he will breathe air. This was the thing that he feared. He does not realize that the invitation extended to him by the king was for his good. Isn't this how we are in our lives? Life has crippled us, and therefore our perspective is such that there is no good that I deserve, and nothing good for me to expect, hiding from the very one that could restore me, hiding from the very one that could turn my lack into plenty, hiding from the very one that can take my darkness and turn it into light, the one that can take my mourning and give me joy that causes me to dance. This is who we are. David has brought Mephib to him that he might show him the kindness of God, to get to know him on a first name basis, to put aside every fear that he had, to bless him for Jonathan's sake, to restore to him all that he had lost, to satisfy his hunger, to fill his lack, and to bring him security. If you were to read the story, you would find that not only did David restore him, but he gave to him everything that his grandfather had owned. He gave back to him everything that his dad had owned. I could preach another message on this, but you have to understand that when you come to God, God will undo and restore things that were stolen generationally from you years past. He will fulfill promises that he made to your great-grandfather. He will restore them in your life if you would simply come before him. Can you imagine Mephibosheth's surprise as he stands before the king and he hears that the king says, "I want to bless you, I want to restore you, I want to give you these things"? This is the same surprise that we have when we realize that God was not some mean old man that we see depicted with a club looking to beat us down every time that we turn around. But we realize that he desires to love us, that he desires to save us, that he desires to restore us, that he desires to bless us. And so Mephibosheth falls in humility before the king, and he proclaims that he is not worthy to receive the love and the kindness of the king. He proclaims himself to be the lowest of value, one that should be shunned. He makes a statement and he says, "I am as a dead dog." Understanding in biblical times, it did not get more unclean and more repulsive than a dead dog. And he says, "That's what I'm like in your presence." But King David covers his malady and gives him a place at the table, a place of position and authority. And he restores everything to this lame man that he had lost. Everything from this moment forward was to be for his good. No longer would Mephibosheth be an outcast living in a place of brokenness. No longer living in a place of discouragement and desolation, but now he was invited to sit at the king's table. He was to be treated, the king said, as one of the king's sons. And he would live in the king's city, a place of plenty. But Mephibosheth was still a cripple, lame in both his feet. But you see, the thing that changed is he was no longer defined by this malady. But now he was identified as one of the king's sons. Now at the table of the king, he is not identified by his past or his past weaknesses, but rather by the position of the king's table. If I had a Bible reader in here this morning, you would begin to get revelation. You see, hear me this morning, you and I are very much like this man Mephibosheth. You and I are lame by something we did not even do, but rather something our first parents did. They dropped us, so to speak. And because of this, the Bible says that sin by one man entered into the world, but Christ came to give us liberty and position. He came to restore that which was lost in my life. This message today is most certainly for both the sinner and the one who considers himself to be a believer. Certainly, as the sinner, we can all relate, for we all know that we are outside of the kingdom of God and the promises of God. But because of the love of God, we have been invited to sit at his table. In the book of Luke chapter 14, Jesus makes a statement within a parable. He had provided, he says, the master had provided a great banquet, and he had invited all of those who were close to them, his friends, to come and partake of this great banquet. I would think that you could make a correlation between the people of God, the Hebrew nation, the Jewish people, as those that were invited first. But they had all kinds of reasons and excuses for why they could not come. And the Bible says that the master was wroth. He was upset. He was offended. He was angry. And Jesus says, go out into the highways and the hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. Who did he send that invitation to? The Bible says just a couple of scriptures before, the poor, the maimed, the halt, and the blind. That's who we were. That's who we are. We can't see where we need to go. We can't get there of our own power. But he reaches out to us where we are and says, come whosoever will. This invite is for you, no matter what your situation or your problem. Undoubtedly, there are those that are here today who have given their lives to Christ, who are blood-bought, spirit-filled, but you have found yourself in a place of failure. Maybe you've become lame, blind, poor, so to speak, by the mistakes and the sinfulness of your choices. You find yourself hiding in your own lodavar, and you are empty and desolate, hoping that no one notices and praying that God does not call on you today, for you know it will be certain judgment should you stand before him. I need you to hear me this morning. God loves you with an everlasting love, a love that will not diminish, a love that cannot be snuffed out, a love that cannot be revoked, and he has invited you to come and be restored. I want you to see something very important within the context of this account of Mephibosheth today. In verse 3 of 2 Samuel chapter 9, when David asked the question, is there anyone of the house of Saul? And his servant Ziba stands up and says, there is a man. There is a son of Jonathan. His name is Mephibosheth. And he is lame in both his feet. The word translated lame in our Bibles is the Hebrew word naka, which means maimed and dejected, means crippled in his extremities, but also crippled within his emotions, within his mind, within his thinking. There is no doubt that this was who Mephibosheth was, physically crippled, crippled in his thinking with his loss of everything, his position, his status, everything is gone, living beneath his original position and destiny. But there is something that we really need to take notice of, and it's in verse 13. And the scripture says this, after David having restored everything, after David telling him that he would be as the king's sons and he would be with him in his house and live in the king's city, verse 13 says this, so Mephibosheth dwelt in Jerusalem, for he did eat continually at the king's table and was lame on both his feet. Now, at first glance, at first reading, you might think, yeah, so he was crippled before he went there, and he's crippled after he got there. But I've talked to you in the past about words and how we need to pay attention to the words that they're translated from. We know that in the New Testament that there are two words power used, and one speaks to ability and one speaks to authority. And we need, when we see words like this used within the same context, we should pay attention. Because the second word, lame, here is from another Hebrew word, which means simply lame. You see, no longer, and I wish Revelation would come right now. No longer is Mephibosheth the guy who was lame and crippled in his feet anymore. But because of the invitation and the restoration of the king, the dejection and the discouragement and the despair is all gone, because he slid up to the table, and the table, the position of authority, changes everything that's beneath the table. This man still had his past, but the difference was the invitation to sit at the king's table. No longer did he need to hide, because now he was able to preside. Now he had been covered and given position, able to rule in the place as the king's son. Hear me this morning. I don't care how far you think you are from God. I don't care what you've done that is contrary to his commands. I don't care how many times you have failed him. I plead with you this morning, receive the invitation of the king. Come in humility and repentance and allow him to restore you to a position of presiding. The Apostle Paul writes to the church at Rome, and he says this, and you know this, Romans chapter 8, there is now therefore no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. And a few verses later, he clarifies for us who he is actually talking about between verses 14 and 17, that these are they that have experienced new birth, that have been born of the Spirit and no longer walk after the flesh. And he goes on to make another powerful statement to the church at Ephesus in chapter 2. And he says that we have been brought near to Christ through his blood, which were once far away. You see, it's the mercy of God. You see, we were outside of the blessing of God. We were outside of the king's house. We lived in a place of destruction and judgment. We lived in a constant state of fear, because we knew that we were not right with a holy God. And if we had to stand in judgment before that holy God, it meant death for all eternity for us. But then the mercy of God, the blood of Christ, begins to draw us near, that we would come to him. I'm going to ask that the musicians would come this morning, and I'm almost done here. But in Luke chapter 15, There's another illustration that I love because I see myself so many times within this illustration. It's the parable of the lost son. It's the parable of the son that the father loved. Yet the son decides he wants his inheritance early, and he wants to go, and he wants to do his own thing. And he leaves the father's house. But it's not long and he finds himself in a place of utter ruin and desolation. Starving, a place of lack. The Bible says he was so hungry that he would have ate the food that they fed to the pigs. A place of despair and loneliness. All the friends that he thought he had had now had forsaken him. The Bible tells us that it's here in the midst of this desolation that he realizes that the door to the Father's house, it's always open and it's calling him. And in that moment, he repents of his failures and he begins to make his way home. The story of the lost son is so important because I would tell you that in the heart of a father, if my child left and went astray as he was hurting and broken, I would want to rush to him. I would want to come and save him and restore him. But that's not what this father does. This father lets him go. His father lets him make his own choices. Lets him sit in the pig pen till the Bible says that he comes to himself. I want you to know that while your heavenly Father loves you and he's always beckoning you to come, he will let you sit in your mess. If you choose to walk away from him, if you choose today to say, "That's not for me," he'll let you leave this place empty. But the Bible says that after the son realized what he had at home, and he begins to make his way home, the Bible says that the father sees him a long way off. And dad starts running, runs to the son. And I can hear the exchange, and the son says, "Dad, I've sinned against you. I've sinned against heaven. I've messed up. I'm not worthy to be your son. I stink. I'm dirty. I'm broken." And dad doesn't even respond to the mess. But he says, "Bring me the best robe." And he covers it. And he puts the ring of authority on his finger, giving him position at the table. Ladies and gentlemen, when we come to Christ, lame in our sins and failures, proclaiming that we are not worthy of his love nor his kindness, he declares us righteous. We keep telling him of who we're not, and he just keeps telling us who we are. See, this morning, he seeks to cover. He looks to restore. He gives us authority by the regeneration of his spirit and also the position of rule by his spirit. Restored by an invitation to the table. The Bible says in the book of Genesis that it's by Adam and Eve, their failure, that they're hiding. Today, I would say that God has called you to be more than just someone who hides. The book of Revelation says that he has now made us to be kings and priests. He has come to restore the relationship that was lost. Today, we no longer need to hide. Today, we no longer need to fear his presence. See, if we would accept the invitation of the King, We could move into the place of presiding as a forgiven, redeemed, and restored child of God. No longer identified by my filth, but identified by the position of the table. I'm a king's kid. And when I speak, he hears. And when my enemy comes against me, if I understand who I am, I preside in a place of authority, and I can take dominion over my enemy. Stand with me this morning. But you see, the struggle that we have is allowing our failures to define us. Allowing our failures to drive us into a place of hiding that separates us from the love and the mercy of God. But I would say today that it's time for the chosen creation of God to have a wake-up call. To stop fearing the knock on the door, knowing that there's impending judgment. But because I've made it right with the King, because I've accepted the invitation to come, to drink of the waters of life freely, to be restored, to be forgiven, to be redeemed, to be as the King's Son. Yes, we will fail. Yes, we have failed. The Bible says we have an advocate with the Father that if we sin, that he is faithful and just to forgive. But yet again, it's an invitation that's been extended. This altar is a tradition. Pastor spoke about tradition so wonderfully a few weeks ago. This is a wonderful tradition. This is a place that you can come and allow the seed of the word to be watered. That you can come and make things right with God. But I would tell you that you can do that in your pew. But I would challenge you today. As Mephibosheth had to, in his crippled way, make his way all the way from Lodabar to the king's house. I want you to know that journey was not easy for him. I guarantee you there were people that were watching. There was anxiety within his heart and his emotions that he felt. You may feel those today as you make your way to this altar. But I want you to know God stands here with arms open wide. Love for you, forgiveness for you. To take you from the pit of despair to the throne of authority. This morning, would you come? Would you talk to him today? Would you let him restore you? And if you are here today and you desire to begin relationship with him, you've not been baptized in the name of Jesus, it can happen for you today. If you need the infilling of the Holy Ghost, that can happen for you today. Please come. Please talk to the Lord. Please respond to the invitation of the King. It's for your good.